IVM.
Hi, I'm Satyajit.
Hi, I'm Rachita.
Welcome to Paperback by the Open Library Project.
We have as our guest today Sudha Menon. Sudha is an author, columnist and writing coach. In the first half of the episode, we discuss Feisty at 50, her latest book, which is a glorious, no-holds-barred journey of a woman in her 50s.
In the second half, we discuss legacy, letters to their daughters from eminent Indian men and women, gifted, inspirational stories of people with disabilities, and Devi, Diva or She-Devil, the smart career woman's survival guide. Happy listening.
Will someone please tell me I'm not the only 50-year-old suffering from FOMO? At the crack of dawn every morning, even before I have relieved my overfull bladder, I reach blindly for my smartphone to check what is happening on FB. And man, there's always a lot going on there. Enough to keep me from going back for a quick cuddle with a significant other who is snoring away. Instead, I sneak out of the room with my phone and sit on the sofa, hungrily lapping up what the world did while I was asleep. And before I know it, the clock strikes 6 and I scramble to brush and don my walking gear to head out the door for an hour's walk. I take my phone along in a sling bag across my shoulder because a smart app on it tells me how many steps I have clocked. The real reason I sneak the phone along, however, is so that I can check Instagram and Twitter and take pictures of random birds, bees, flowers and such others that I can load on my social media handles during the day so that the equally random people who check out my posts can eat their heart out over my enviable life. Oh, she lives in a gated society with lush greenery around her, they probably think to themselves, admiring the video of the peacock that comes calling in my backyard every morning, pecking away at God alone knows what it is that showers down from the badam tree in my backyard. They have no idea that the hysterical calls of the peacocks, I would sound like that if somebody came after me with a butcher's knife, keep me awake half the night. Some days I'm most tempted to open the window and bung a stone at whichever gang of stray dogs is holding their private orchestra under my bedroom window. Only, I would rather suffer the racket caused by them than face the music from the clutch of rabid animal lovers in the neighborhood who go around preaching love for animals and treat human beings like inanimate objects to be trampled on. Oh well, it takes all kinds to make this wonderful world of ours and I'm all for coexistence. I can live and share the planet with as many dogs as it can bring on, so long as they don't bite my backside. Very painful, I can tell you, from having been bitten thrice on the aforementioned part of the anatomy.
Thank you, Sudha Menon. That was an extract from her book, Feisty at 50. We'll be right back after this to discuss the book in more detail.
Remember the last vacation you took? What about the one you took 3 years ago? Okay, how much do you really remember? It's a question I've asked myself often over a decade of traveling the world. Hey, I'm Utsav and I do not travel the world for a living. I have a full-time job and responsibilities, but I have made traveling the world a priority. Priority enough that I negotiate extra leave in my job contracts, obsessively track my frequent flyer miles, and I'm willing to take off at the sight of a cheap ticket. Yes, I am cheap. I've lived and worked in 3 countries. I understand human behavior for a living. And these experiences have given me unique insights into places, people, and culture. With over a decade of travel behind me, I increasingly realized one thing, that we cannot see everything. So whatever we see, we must see deeply. Because as the film of memory decays, the imprints which will stand the test of time are the ones felt by the immersion of the senses, not by fleeting encounters with them. Postcards from Nowhere is an immersion into the world of slow travel, one story at a time. Tune in every Thursday on the IVM Podcasts app, website, or wherever you get your podcast from.
Welcome to Paperback by the Open Library Project. I'm your co-host Satyajit, otherwise known as Onion Knight in most food circles. I'm hosting this podcast with my co-founder at the Open Library Project, Racheta Sharma.
Hi guys, my name is Racheta. I'm an ex-banker, social impact entrepreneur, podcaster, writer, publisher, and inveterate learner. The Open Library Project is a curated library service which is offered to corporates on a subscription basis. The idea here is to create value, build a knowledge community, and encourage a growth mindset amongst our members.
Oh, wow. That's like so much multitasking. I love that.
Thank you.
That is my life energy. You know, I love meeting women who do so much with their lives. I just can't understand sitting on the sofa doing nothing. This is it, you know. I need to be doing stuff.
Yeah.
Wow.
So you're like amazing.
Thank you, Sudha. Thank you so much.
So today we have on the show Sudha Menon, and Sudha is an author, columnist, and writing coach. She has authored multiple books. The first one that we're going to talk about today, and then we're going to talk about the rest of them as well. The first one is Feisty at 50, which sounds hilarious.
Yeah.
I imagined
everything you spoke
seriously,
about.
Seriously, it created such a vivid picture in my mind of, you know, exactly the gated colony and exactly, you know, the dogs, definitely, because I have the same orchestra outside my...
Yeah, dog orchestra, yes.
I have it, in fact, inside my house and outside my house. So it's great to have you on the show, Sudha.
Thank you very much. Love being here.
Awesome. So, this book, Feisty at 50, is your fifth novel. And this book is about being 50 and how...
Being fabulous at 50.
Tell us a little bit about this book.
It's about, you know, it's not just another book. Mm-hmm. All the books that I've written in the last 10 years, mm-hmm. I used to think each one of them, when I write them, mm-hmm. I think that's my most favorite baby.
Right.
And then I wrote Feisty at 50.
Right.
And I just think I had so much fun writing this. Mm-hmm. I had just such a blast writing this. And I call it a book of my adventures as a woman of 50 plus. And it is really, really adventurous. You know, you said it was hilarious, and it is. If it was not happening to me, mm-hmm. It is really hilarious. Because the stuff that happens in a woman on the wrong side of 50 is like so much stuff happening there.
Right.
And we all pretend. You know, the thing about this book is that I wrote it, I didn't... Like all my other books are based on interviews with very accomplished people and women from all walks of life and women we all admire. For this book, I didn't do anything. I just sat on the sofa and thought about my life and all the things that make me angry, joyful, bitter, whatever.
Yeah.
And I realized that when I was writing it, I was laughing more than... writing.
Right.
And then one day my sister told me that, you know, this is the kind of stuff you should write.
Mm-hmm.
You've been writing all those books and they made a lot of impact. But if this gives you so much joy, just write it.
Yeah.
Right.
And I just had fun. Like everything in this book, the raw material is my life. And of course, the poor, unfortunate people in my life who are written
who get documented by default.
Completely. For the longest time, after I wrote the book and it went to the publisher, I lived in this fear that I'm going to lose half the people I know because they're all in the book.
Yeah.
Friends, husband, daughter, sister, mother, everybody. Thankfully for me, they all loved it. They didn't mind being poked fun of because they also saw that I poked most fun of me.
So
it's okay. Right. I was not talking down. I was just trying to make light of something which otherwise can be very depressing, you know.
Right.
Because society treats people who are aging very badly.
Mm-hmm.
With much insensitivity.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, you're in your 40s and your 50s, you don't even exist anymore.
Yeah, it's like asking you to give up before you want to give up on anything.
They are telling you to give up.
Yeah,
you know, they are telling, they have already consigned you to this sort of dustbin of history.
Mm,
and you just stay there and don't talk. Just breathe, but don't talk and don't get in our way.
Right. So tell us a little bit about maybe a couple of instances in the book which, you know, you really feel that at 50, it's kind of being challenged for you.
Oh, everything. Everything. Everything about being 50 is challenging.
Right.
Right from not being able to see without your specs to, you know, I don't know whether other women experience this, but there is this thing which goes on with my spectacles.
Mm-hmm.
Like I wear it to read, but I don't realize it and I look up and I'm like, oh my God, I've gone blind. And then I realize I've forgotten to remove my specs.
Yeah.
So this this sort of circles happens several times in the day. Right. Then there is a time when I go to the I love bookstores, mm-hmm. and I go to a bookstore, and of course, like all authors, mm. the secret mission, of course, is to make sure that my books are there.
Yeah. You know? And ask for it like 2-3 times. Bhaiya, ye book nahi mil raha hai. It's a famous book hai.
Yeah. And in the end, when they find it, I say, I'm the author. And then you wait for the ego massage.
Yeah.
But oftentimes it is delivered. Most times they couldn't care less, you know, right. because there are authors.
Yeah.
And,
mm-hmm. yeah.
But I have this thing when I go to the bookstore, I want to look up at all the books. I look down, I pick up a book, you know, off the shelf. I look down, I read it, and then I want to keep it up, and I'm all blind. So this is crazy, you know. That we have got so much technology has happened, mm-hmm. and we still can't find a solution to this madness that happens between reading glass and long distance reading glass. And
right.
yeah. there are people who say that, of course, progressives work, but they really don't.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Other than give me a migraine, that did right. nothing. So I went to China 2 months ago, and. They make everything fake. So I bought myself a fabulous fake progressive of a brand that I won't name. Mm-hmm. And I used it. And other than giving me the mother of all migraines, it did nothing for my reading.
Right.
So I'm back to my specs kind of thing.
Yeah.
The other thing about being 50, of course, is, you know, you both are not in that age group at all. But I know that every person who's listening to this podcast... Mm-hmm. who is in their 50s, will realize what it means being 50 and going to a mall. Mm-hmm. Because you go there wanting, you know, there are days when I'm just sitting on the sofa, when I've decided I'm not going to write anything.
Right.
And I'm done with reading and all for the day. I just want to hang around, you know.
Yeah.
So I said, okay, I'm going to, I have this thing about one day I'm going to become glamorous. You know, I'm also going to be that. I'm just going to stop being the auntie in the sari. That's right. what I'm always
You look gorgeous in a sari, by the way.
I'm called auntie all the time.
I would disagree.
Auntie in the sari. So then I say, okay, now let me just go get myself some, you know, glamorous clothes and all. So I go to a mall and there are all these big brands and every, you know, people dress to go to the mall like they're already in a fashion show.
Yeah. Right.
And my idea of dressing up is salwar kameez, you know, mostly sometimes sneakers because...
so comfy to walk in the mall.
It's comfy and you don't want to hobble, you know, on heels. The heels are pain on the heel. Is paining because of stilettos and all. So I say, you know, I'm going to spend my money. I'm going to have a good time.
Mm-hmm.
I go to the mall and I want the first... Just today I read that Kareena Kapoor is wearing boyfriend jeans.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, every 6 months there is a new kind of jeans. And how... I think the last pair of jeans I bought was when I was like 35 or something. Because you just don't... I don't have the energy to try out jeans anymore.
Right.
Because you walk into a denim store and they have like 100 types of jeans.
Hmm.
You know, flared ones, boot cut ones, then
bottom.
Long ones, short ones, jeggings, leggings, slim
ones,
high waist, ripped ones.
Yeah.
I once went with my mother to London and one day I had to go somewhere. And she didn't want to come with me. So I went and I've always wanted to wear ripped jeans. Because I saw Jennifer, J-Lo wearing ripped jeans. And I said, you know, she's around my age. So maybe I can also wear it.
Mm.
So I went to H&M and I bought myself ripped jeans. And I came home and I like went and put it in my bag. I didn't show my mother. Because, you know, if you, no matter how old you are, mother knows best. So I didn't show my mother my ripped jeans. And the next day I had to go somewhere. So I came bounding down the stairs in my ripped jeans.
Mm-hmm.
And my mom looked at me and said, you need to buy new jeans. Because those are like really... She says, you can't go around saying you're a best-selling author and wear torn jeans. So that was the end of my ripped jeans.
So, oh, no.
Yeah, that after that I never wore it. I just lost my self-confidence.
So you've done a podcast also around, you know, Feisty at 50 and... various people's experiences when they're 50. So, could you share some of those with us?
So, all kinds of... I can share my experiences of being 50.
Yeah.
It goes around from, you know, there are days... Like, there have been so many times when I've looked at... You go to a salon and you sit down and you're having a haircut. And you have all these glossies, you know, which Vogue and Cosmopolitan and Elle and all sorts of magazines. And they're all saying the top five red lipsticks a woman must have. And I'm like, I don't have a single red lipstick. And I say, okay. So next day I go very dutifully. I go to the, you know, wherever mall and say that I'm going to buy myself some sexy red lipstick. So you go and then the first thing about being 50 is you realize that you're invisible. You know, nobody sees you. You go to the counter and malls have all the makeup cosmetic counters. You know, they're just
one after the other.
All of them are there.
Yeah.
And they see you and you're obviously looking for something, but not a single pipsqueak will attend to you because they think, what is she going to buy? You know, she's not glamorous and she's not young. So what is she going to see? They think they are just looking. And also, they are so busy painting their own faces that there's certainly no time for attending to anybody else.
Right.
And then there has been a time, there was once, somebody told me you have to buy Ruby Woo. So I said, okay, I'm going to buy Ruby Woo. So I went and I got treated really badly because the person behind the brand which was selling Ruby Woo didn't probably like my face or didn't think I was glamorous enough. So I glared at her. She didn't notice. And I just walked away with my tail in between and then went to the next counter. That is one of India's largest cosmetic brands. So I said, can I have some red lipstick? So they came, you know, the girl there showed me a maroon. And she showed me very washed out sort of something.
Dullish colors.
Very dull. Then something even duller. And I said, excuse me, I want red lipstick. So can you show me some red lipsticks? And she said, ma'am, aapke age ke auntie ke liye aunties yehi pehnte hain. Aap brown, can I show you some browns, ma'am? Aunties your age only wear brown. So this is number one thing about aging or being in your 50s, that people are making your decisions for you.
Right.
So you can't wear dangerously low jeans or you can't wear boyfriend jeans or you can't, if you're past 50, they usually assume that you want mommy jeans, you know, where three of you can fit into that jeans.
Yeah.
Or they don't make sizes for you because, oh, ma'am, we only keep till size 30. That's our biggest size. And then they'll give you this look, you know, like, how dare you come here and ask.
Yeah, if you're not 30, you have no right to ask for this.
Yeah. I also have had, at various points in my life, I've always... There is a saying, you know, when you get to your 50s and women go out and hang around with friends, inevitably the discussion will sometimes come towards middle-aged sex, of which there is none. But, you know, you of which, because by that time, there is so much familiarity that it only breeds contempt, you know, nothing else is bred. So women can be very, very... snark when it comes to talking about their sex lives or lack of it.
Right.
But also we discuss these things. So over lunch and lots of samosas and stuff, we'll say, "Tu hai na yaar, kuch sexy wala lingerie le le. Ye kya hai?" And I pretend that this conversation has nothing to do with me. But at the end of it, I will also slink off sometimes to buy sexy lingerie. And there is no such thing for a 50-year-old. You know, even those... for 20-somethings. So the thing is, there is no place for old women. And I don't think I'm old, but...
Not at all. Like,
everybody says you're old.
Yeah, I mean, they want to make you feel that even if you're not feeling it.
Yeah. So they give you a label, they put you in a box, and they put you in a corner. And you're just supposed to lump it and, you know, be happy with your life.
So I think this book, Feisty at 50, is a great book for, I think, anyone who's around even 50, even in their 40s. To sort of start preparing themselves for what is inevitable.
Yeah, and but my book is not about the depressive bits of it.
Yeah.
My book is about how to combat that.
Right, yeah. And how to enjoy your 50s.
Absolutely, and to have the most fun and to make sure that nobody in their 50s feels that it's the end of their life. Because my biggest adventures are happening now. You know, I never imagined that my 50s would be so rocking because all my life... Especially when you're younger,
right?
In that time, if you're in your 40s, when I was a kid, women of over 40 had already given up on their lives.
Yeah.
You know, and they were preparing to retire and look after children. I have told my daughter, you have to put one continent between me and the grandchild. Because I'm just coming into my own. I'm not going to hold anybody's baby. I'll be nice to the grandchild, yeah. but I'm not going to be... Yeah, you know, chief
fair.
Nurturer.
Yeah. Yeah,
because I have so much things to
chief
do.
Chief nurturer. I like yeah. that. Chief sounds dignified.
So yeah, so that is the thing about being 50.
But yeah.
Have fun. I'm having lots of fun. I've
You're rocking your 50s.
Yes. And I feel that there is only so much time.
Mm-hmm.
And there are my bucket list is like...
Too long.
Very
yeah,
long.
Yeah, yeah. It's great and to have a bucket list that is...
Yes. I never had a bucket list till mm-hmm. I was 50. I was just... till I was 40,
mm-hmm.
I was being a journalist and mm-hmm. getting my kicks from seeing my byline in the newspapers.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That, yeah. you know... And then... How many bylines can you
enjoy? Like
yeah,
after a while, it's like
after time it was yeah. like a sleepwalking through it.
Right.
Then 10 years I wrote books.
Mm-hmm.
I never had a bucket list. Everything mm-hmm. just happened organically.
Right. Yeah.
And then there is something, you know. But I've been 3 years now into my 50s. At 53, I feel there is so much more I want to do, and I'm ticking it off one
yeah.
by one, and I'm yeah. just so much enjoying the process.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
And,
yeah. In these yeah. times, I don't think age is really a barrier for
no,
your
dreams. I think I have never felt more joyous or empowered or, you know, I'm just good.
Yeah.
My younger days were spent in worrying about what would the neighbor say, what would the
right.
father say, what would my mother say, and generally being, you know, pussyfooting around everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Don't mm-hmm. offend anybody.
Right.
Do you think that's why like women sort of want to retire at 50? Because, you know, once your child is a little older and your husband is on his own. Yeah, mm-hmm. on his own trip.
Yeah.
So do you feel like they feel sort of lost suddenly because, you know, what you're used to doing for so long, then, you know, you suddenly have a lack of... In fact, your children don't want to have anything to do with you.
It's basically mom chill
right.
and disappear.
Exactly.
Huh?
So maybe, you know, that's why they've lost interest in... you know, sort of looking after themselves, which is mainly the essence of this book, is that you should be able to love yourself at whatever age. So,
yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
You know, most women, because of the way our society has been,
mm-hmm.
it's always a woman, even if she has had women with a career, at least, you know, when they get out of the house, I think they have more exposure
yeah.
To other things. You meet more people, you remain a little interested or interesting. But what I have seen with, like, I worked from home from the time I was 32.
Yeah.
And it is very isolating. Mm. You know, I've always had a work from home situation because I was primary carer for my daughter.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So I've always chose newspapers who would support my decision to work from home.
Yeah.
I would do the best job. So they had no complaints. But my thing was, I want to be at home and
yeah.
do my work because I was chief career, you know, carer for her.
Yeah.
And I found that if you are at home more, then you tend to look inward a lot.
Yeah.
And you
right.
tend to get, you know, you tend to get into a zone where there is no connection with the outside world. It's just you, your work, your child, your home. And
yeah.
it becomes very boring. And it saps, you know, not interacting with enough people saps your self-confidence in some way.
Yeah.
You lose your confidence, your self-esteem, and you... I don't know. At one point, it happened to me.
Mm.
And I think my 50s is my answer to all the years I spent
in
sitting at home,
yeah.
writing.
Yeah,
and yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So now I'm just out and I refuse to be tied down. It's like I have skates on my feet.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
On that note, we're going to take a short break and we'll be right back after this.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I'd like to thank our sponsors on the network this week. Thank you, HDSC Life, for coming on board. We're really excited to work with you. Also, would like to thank Storytel for continuing the long-time advertising that they've been doing with us. And if you have a brand and you'd like to advertise with us, please send us an email. We'd love to talk to you. Also, folks, please fill out our listener survey. This is the last week it's going to be up. I'm going to take it down at the end of January. Please do try and get your opinion in before then. It is kind of important and it helps us kind of figure out what we should be doing going forward. On Cyrus Says, Cyrus is joined by actor Manvi Gagru, who talks about her upcoming film Shubh Mangal Zyada Savdhan, working on TVF's popular web series Pictures, and how talent show brought her from Delhi to Mumbai. On Advertising is Dead, Varun talks to film critic Sucharita Tyagi, known for the popular Not a Review film series on Film Companion. On Ugla Station Adulthood, Ritasha asks Ayushi 36 questions. On Mr. and Mrs. Binge Watch, Janice and Aniru talk about season 2 of Netflix's hit show You. On Geek Fruit, Tejas, Jishnu and Dinkar talk about Netflix's Dracula series. On Postcards from Nowhere, Utsav decodes the secrets hidden behind different doors. On IVM Likes, Abbas, Ritika and Antarish talk about their favorite depictions of heaven, hell and the afterlife in pop culture. On Edges and Sledges, DJ Ashwin and Varun talk about India bouncing back from a 10-wicket thrashing at Wankhede. On Ganatantra's one-year anniversary episode, hosts Alok and Saryu talk about police reform and why it's so hard. And with that, let's get you back to your show.
Welcome back, guys. We still have with us Sudha Menon. And hey, Sudha, that first half was amazing. great conversation. I think we were just laughing through most of it.
Yeah, thank you. Totally relatable for a woman. Even though I'm not of that age, I totally understand a lot of things that you mentioned. Because you see it around, you know, mm-hmm. at home all the time.
A lot of men bought this book for their wives or their mothers.
Yeah.
And then they, you know, because of social media, people are able to connect with you very seamlessly.
Right.
And then they'll write saying that, you know, I gave this, when I heard you talk about the book, mm-hmm. it was like you're talking about my mother.
Right.
Yeah. Exactly.
Or you're talking about my wife. And now I understand that better. Mm-hmm. I understand my wife better. So, yeah, I'm glad I wrote it.
I think for a lot of guys, even it's just ignorance.
Yes, like, mostly yes.
It's not anything done out of, hopefully it's not. But usually I think once you read about another point, another person's perspective or the female perspective to the same situation, so it kind of helps.
It is.
And so the next book that we are going to is another one of your books. It's Legacy, Letters to Daughters from Eminent Indian Men and Women. And so tell us a little bit about this book. So you've written a lot of books before this book, which were sort of, you had conversations.
Women and leadership.
Right.
You know, this book was very special to me because I wrote this book the year my daughter was turning 21.
Okay.
And there was so much I wanted to tell her, you mm-hmm. know, about how, the things that are really important for a woman to know, the things she should learn, the attitudes, you know, and the virtues and... Not virtue mm-hmm. as in, what is that, sanskari, wali. No, not that.
Right.
But just good habits, the right attitude and all of that. Mm. But you know how it is between mothers and children.
You have to write a book for them to understand that.
Because direct conversation would be like, mom, don't give me bhashan. No, that bhashan word was like, she has allergy and I have allergy. So I said, instead of, I wanted to write her a letter, but mm-hmm. I thought, knowing young people, she would think it is very cheesy. Mm-hmm. So I said, let me not write this letter. I tried feebly to write a letter to her. Then I said, this is like surely going to get laughed at.
Right.
So I said, instead of doing all this, I said, let me talk to people who we all admire. You know, there are so many people. India has so many men and women who we can learn so much from.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, It was just one of those aha moments for me. I said, instead of me writing this letter, let me talk to them. Let me talk to these people, people with daughters.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because I wanted from them, what are the things that they are teaching for their teaching their daughters? Or what are the things that they hope for their daughters, wishing for their daughters? And I had the most amazing time, you know, meeting Mr. Narayana Murthy, mm-hmm. Mr. Prakash Padukone, so many men and women of... so much stature, you know, and just sit with them and talk to them about their daughters. And I remember when I met Mr. Murthy, for instance, he had told me, I can meet you for 20 minutes in Bangalore. I live in Pune.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought to myself, 20 minutes, you know.
Is it worth the trip all the way?
Then I said, but this is not just, I've met Mr. Murthy in press conferences and media. I said, but this is not that. This is something special. Mm-hmm. And this is a book that I want to write for my daughter.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And of course, it is worth it. And I went there. And I think it was the day before his son was getting married. Or 2 days before his son was getting married. And I went there and we spoke for over an hour.
Wow.
And, you know, it just... I think the conversation just went on and on till a call came from... I'm thinking it's from his home.
Yeah.
Then he said, Sudha, you know, there's a wedding in the house. I better go.
Yeah.
And that's how that thing, Mr. Padukone, I met. And for me, that was like such a special moment.
Yeah.
Because he was my childhood hero. You know, okay. I remember sitting on, you know, on the sofa with my father and seeing him play. I must have been, what, 8 or 9 or 10 or whatever, I don't know. But he was this hero. Yeah. Who, you know, the entire nation was like in awe of him. Mm-hmm. And then for me to go and meet him, and such a simple, humble man. Mm-hmm. And so much like us, you know. He might be this legend, but so much like all of us.
Yeah.
And talking about things about raising his two daughters and how... He said,
even the value system, right? It's absolutely so similar. You may be an actor, you may be a politician, or you can be anybody, but you want to basically give the same things to your child.
Honesty and hard work, and you know, being sincere, and to not have the bad, well, the bad attitude towards life.
Yeah, absolutely.
These are the things they all basically spoke about.
Yeah,
I remember Mr. Padukone saying that for the rest of the world, she's Deepika Padukone. You know, she's a big superstar. But he says, for us, she's our daughter, and she's come home. And when she comes home, and if there are visitors at home, she still has to sleep on the ground. Yeah. You know, the mattress goes down, and she sleeps on that. And she still has to help her mother clean the dishes after dinner.
Right.
So that is how we have raised her.
Yeah.
And this is also simple. But for me, it was very special. Because then you realize... during the writing of this book, I also realized, like Nandita Das, for instance, my meeting with her. And I met her because I also wanted to know the daughter's point of view.
Yeah.
So I also met Nandita Das after her father wrote, I interviewed the father. So she told me that till I was almost 10 years old, I did not even realize, I did not even know that usually it was the father who goes to work and the mother who stays at home. Because she says, my mother always went to work and my father worked at home because he was painting.
Right.
And so she says that there are so many times I would be in the balcony and my father would be, you know, plaiting my hair. And then the school bus would come and he would walk me to the school bus.
Yeah.
And she said, it's only much later when I was 10 or 12 or something, I started realizing that what was being practiced in our home in terms of, you know, role reversal and gender equality was extraordinary.
Yeah.
He was the one who raised me.
Yeah.
And my mother went to work while all around me, it was...
the opposite.
It was the opposite.
Yeah.
And I always feel that you can only really influence your children by setting an example.
Absolutely.
You can be preaching them all the good values, but they unless that's what they're seeing you do, it's never going to be a part of them. So
absolutely.
I think what you've done is amazing. You write a book about it and then you go like, see, 50, you know, smart people are saying this, it's not me. So very, very good strategy.
And you know, it that book was for me, in so many ways, I think I learned more about life. Than my daughter did, because I had the opportunity to meet all of them at close quarters, listen to their thought process based on those conversations. I wrote those letters for them. And it was just, it forged bonds for me.
Definitely.
And I learned like huge amounts of stuff about life from them. And I also think that if you write with a sincerity of purpose, it shows, you know, like Legacy remains one of my most most popular books.
Yeah, it's
and
a bestseller.
Even even now, when there is like corporate houses will say that we want to buy this book in bulk, or will you come and talk about this? Because I think no matter how grown up we are or how sophisticated we become, we really want the simple things in our life. Also, deep down, we are all
always
uncomplicated.
So we.
Yes, the good old values.
So
many young people will buy for their daughters, and it is so special.
Yeah,
you know, that bond with your daughter. I mean, I'm sure mothers of sons are going to hate me for this, but I think that that bond with your daughter is so special, and I felt it when I did all those interviews.
Right.
So I'm glad I wrote that book and followed my instinct.
Yeah,
that is a big thing with me, that I write about only things that I really feel very strongly about.
That's
Otherwise, I'd say
that's the, I think the key to successful writing is to really first decide what you want to write about, as opposed to what people want to read.
Yes.
Because like, that's what you will be able to define the best.
Absolutely. Because because there is, I don't buy this theory that ye chalta hai. Ye type ke book chalta hai. I say just too bad, but I'm not wanting to write that. Right. I want to write what I feel, what touches my heart.
Right. Absolutely. And you've written a very, you know, special book also, which is for differently abled people.
Yes.
Called Gifted, which is the next book we're discussing. So, you know, this is that also super, super special because, you know, it is a topic which we see so often, you know, and a discrimination, like you mentioned in Feisty at 50.
Yes.
Which is also a sort of discrimination. We see this happening throughout the lives of differently abled people. So, you know, do share your experiences.
So, Gifted was a book which came, it was serendipity. You know, I went to Bangalore to launch my book Legacy in Bangalore. And I invited three people to launch that book, and one of the Captain Gopinath of Air Deccan. Then Vinita Bali of Britannia.
Nice.
And VR Firoz, who was then the MD of SAP in Bangalore. And it was a fabulous discussion because this topic inevitably gets the conversation going. So the audience wants to talk and everybody is talking. And at the end of it, Firoz just told me that, you know, you write with so much feeling that there is this topic that I've always wanted to write, but I don't have the time to follow it up. So he said, I want to write a book about people who are differently abled.
Right.
Because there is so much in their life that we can learn from, you know, their fighting spirit. And the fact that despite all of us treating them like they don't even exist,
right,
they have made so much out of their lives, you know. And and it's like crippling, the neglect that we have meted out to them. He said, would you consider co-authoring a book with me? And I said, of course I will. I would love to do that because I'm immensely moved by the human condition. You know, you see something and it just cries out to be touched.
You know,
and addressed.
You hurt your, the last finger of your toe and you're just like, oh my God.
It's hurt.
I'm in so much pain. And that's when you realize every part of your body is so important for your functioning.
Yes.
That people who can do it without it and still manage to lead a dignified life is beautiful. And I always, struggle to find that balance. Like, while sometimes I feel that, you know, by this making them feel like, oh, you're gifted or you're special or you're differently able, am I trying to, you know, put them in a position of pity and not giving them what they deserve, which should be based on, say, caliber or, you know. And then sometimes you feel that, you know, because they have these disabilities, you have to be equally encouraging, so for which you need to have those quotas and that special treatment so that they get what they've not been getting. So this balance, you know, how do you think you strike that balance?
So I wrote about, in Gifted, I wrote about 18 people who have overcome the worst kind of, you know, crippling disabilities, you know, and there is... there is Ashwin Karthik, for instance. It's like one of my favorites from the book. Ashwin Karthik was born quadriplegic. When he was born, his doctor told his mother that you can take your baby home, but he'll only always be a doll. He will not be able to do anything at all. So please don't expect anything. Just be happy that you have a child. And Ashwin's mother took the baby home, and then she swore to herself that, I'm never, ever allowing my baby to be a doll. He will do everything that the rest of the world does. And at some point, and they were born, he was born in Coorg. And they actually traveled to Bangalore because raising the child was so much more difficult there. And along the way, his father passed away. His father was his biggest support system. The father passed away, but the mother said, I'm not going to give up. And that's when they traveled to Bangalore too. Ashwin was the first engineering graduate, quadriplegic engineering graduate in India. And today he's risen so rapidly up his up the ranks. Now he has a position where he is advisor at Dell for their engineering management program. And he's, you know, he's broken every stereotype that there is about how it is to be differently abled. And he has moved from a phase where people would not believe that he could do anything with his life. So despite an engineering gold medalist, his mother would have to lock him in the house and go and work because nobody was giving her son a job. So she had to fend for the family. And from there to work slowly and, you know, but steadily and reach a position like this. He's one of the most inspiring people I know. People say that some of the people I meet, you know, every year there is this Firoz, who's my co-author on the book. He organizes something called the India Inclusion Summit.
Okay.
Which is like a giant one-day celebration of people with disability and their ability. They showcase their abilities. And when I go there and I participate, I always feel that we have all our faculties and all our abilities, what is called normally able. You know, this is, I find all this terminology a little, you know.
Right.
What is normally able? What is differently able? People who are differently able, I say, don't call me differently abled. I'm disabled. It's okay. It's okay. That's part
of accepting of, you know, who they are. And that's great, I think.
So the thing is, somebody asked me the other day, I was speaking at HSBC in Bangalore last week. And the question actually came up, you know, that people sometimes discriminate against normally abled people so that they can, you know,
make differently abled people feel special.
And all that. So they asked me, what is your take on it? And my take on it is that two things. One, of course, is don't assume that because he is differently abled, he cannot do this, that or the other. You know, you would be doing them a disservice if you assume on that their behalf that they can't do something. You know, everybody can do everything. But having said that, it's also not fair to expect a differently abled person to run at the same speed as a normally abled person. Given sort of level playing field, both will perform at the same sort of speed. So we have to be aware of that.
And provide them those opportunities.
Yes, provide them the opportunities. Have compassion and empathy. You know, don't throw them to the wolves. On the other hand, don't make them feel crippled if they are not. You know, because most of them, this is a stereotype that plays out. That Firoz, for instance, my friend who was MD of SAP, he started an autism at work project in Bangalore.
Okay.
Where he put people on the autism spectrum at work at SAP, doing testing jobs. And they did so brilliantly that SAP now has a global program where 1% of their employee force all over the world are people on the spectrum.
Okay.
So what's happening is that project is now being copied by a lot of, you know, not copied, followed by a lot of corporate houses.
Right.
But the flip side of it is that now they think they can only be doing testing jobs. That's not the fact. They can do so much more. They can do so much more.
Yeah, and I think, you know, what's beautiful about all your books is whether, you know, you're at 50 or you're a daughter or you are gifted, it is basically you need one person to just believe in you, and that's about it. And just by writing this, you're really, really promoting that, which is
And, you know, this book, I think because it spoke with sincerity, again, that's the thing that you have to understand. You have to get into the shoes of that person you're writing with. And then it becomes easier.
Right.
You know, you see the world from their eyes. And then it becomes so much easier to get into that zone. And Gifted has been translated into 7 Indian languages. And couple more are happening. So it is a source of constant joy to us.
Right.
That's a simple book about people with disability. My publisher had told me that this might not sell. Do you really want to write this book? And I said, please let me follow my instinct on this. I said, I will deliver a book which will sell. And I'm so happy that, you know, none of my other books are in 8 languages. But this book is. And it continues to find people who will come and say, can we do the next language edition kind of. So it's, you have to just be authentic, I think.
And you're adding that meaning to your work, which is
And very quickly, before we end the show, the last book we are going to talk about is Devi, Diva or She-Devil.
Yes.
And this is again a collection of interviews with women leaders.
And women from across all walks of life. And this book was written because, you know, I wrote my first book, Leading Ladies, when I was 40.
Okay.
And that book was written because when I was in my 20s and when I was being an ambitious journalist and trying to raise a daughter and trying to be everything that a woman is expected to be.
Right.
You know, good mother, good sister, good daughter-in-law, good everything.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So I would always wonder, you know, there are all these women. I was a business journalist.
Yeah.
And so I would come in contact with all these women leaders. Right. And they would always be, you know, impeccably dressed and full, completely in charge of their lives, corner office and all of that. And I would always think, you know, what is it that I'm doing wrong?
Right.
Or what is it that they're doing right? Why am I always so hassled and running around and feeling out of control? Constantly playing catch up, yes.
Mm.
And I wrote that book because I wanted to be inspired and I wanted to be motivated.
Yeah.
And I wanted women like me of that age, I wanted them not to do the same things that I did.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And, you know, feel not good enough, feel inadequate. Mm. So I said, let me bring these stories of these women, you know, immensely successful. They're actually the torchbearers for Indian women of now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, the women who are in leading ladies. And I said, let me bring them the stories of those women so that when you read about them, you will actually feel that, okay, if they have got past the huge difficulties, it can't have been easy. Like Sudha Murthy is not in my book, but imagine being a gold medalist engineer and not being given a job because you're a woman. She actually applied. Sudha Murthy was in Pune, where I live. And she went to Tata Motors and despite having all the qualifications, told, we're sorry that you're a woman and you can't work on the shop floor. Mm. And did you know that she actually wrote a letter to Mr. DRD Tata?
Oh,
and stinging letter saying that this is who I am and I'm qualified. I have all the things that you needed for that job.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And because she actually got a letter back from Mr. Tata, and she got the job.
Oh,
and
Wow.
So there is another woman, Leela Punawala, one of my favorite women. She was the first managing female managing director of Atlas Copco, Alfa Laval, Alfa Laval, and then Sandvik. These are the torchbearers, and I wanted to write about them to say that, you know, they did all this at a time in history, working in the, you know, on the shop floor, Leela Punawala.
Mm-hmm. Right.
At a time when it was inconceivable that a woman could go to a shop floor and work there.
Right, right.
So I wrote that book. Then 10 years later, 6 years later, 7 years later, the situation has completely changed.
Yeah.
You know, now there are women everywhere, and it's women are at the top places at a lot of banks, in a lot of corporate houses.
Much more accepting.
So much more,
yeah.
But also what has come along with that is that there are problems.
Mm.
And those problems are not spoken about.
Yes.
You know, because I think when I wrote Reading Ladies, what I noticed was that most of the women never acknowledged that their lives were extremely, challenging.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's not just at the workplace, but generally it is extremely... That time, the book was, the women were all talking about, we can do it and you have to dream big. And
right.
When I wrote Devi Diva and She Devil because I wanted, women are now in larger numbers at the workplace. But what is also true is that the challenges are now like multiplied immensely because the situation, the world we are living in is also so much different now.
Yeah.
And the competition and the non-stop being on the treadmill.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to know because I have sometimes felt it, you know. Sometimes I have felt overwhelmed with the amount of things that I have to do.
Yeah.
And I've struggled to find out, how do you survive this?
Right.
And, you know, survive this and tell the tale. You know, you have to be there. You can't just martyr yourself for the job.
Yeah.
And I said, what I need actually is a guidebook.
Right.
You know. And so I said, smart woman's career. You know, the smart... Career Woman Survival Guide.
Mm.
And that's why I wrote that book. And I'm amazed at how, you know, when you sit across women who are successful and who have gotten there, if you get their confidence, then they are very happy to share with you, you know, their survival tips and the things they do, the things to avoid,
right.
All of that. So writing this book was like immensely empowering for me.
Yeah, I think in Leading Ladies, it was about the women who sort of created that disruption, you know, for women. Yeah. And then this book talks about, you know, women who have like benefited. And then they had their own struggles because, you know, it was a new format. Women were never there. So then problems were new.
And also, what do they do?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, how do they tackle different situations?
Right.
Like, you know... I remember this meeting with Mary Kom. Mm-hmm. I met Mary Kom in Pune when she was training for the London Olympics.
Okay.
And I would go from my home, you know, travel across the city because the training facilities are like in the outskirts of Pune.
Okay.
I would go there and I remember this one day, it was pouring outside and she came in after a entire day spent at in the boxing ring. And she came and we sat in the coffee shop and her children were around, you know, playing with a nanny. They know that mom is at work and not to disturb.
Yeah.
Mm. You know, that there itself was a first lesson for me.
Right.
That she had trained her children to understand that the mother is doing something of significance. So when she's ready, she will attend to you. But till then, they were trained enough and knowledgeable enough not to keep butting in. And,
right.
And then she talked of this time when she talked about her life and it was, you know, it was so illuminating to just understand how tough it is for a woman in a man's world.
Yeah.
So she talked about the time when she was young and the village would laugh at her. The villagers would laugh at her saying, you can't be a boxer. You're a girl.
Mm.
And she would say, do you see me working shoulder to shoulder with my father in the fields?
Yeah.
I'm doing as much as him.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because we have to put food on the table for my siblings.
Right.
And then... when she became a boxer of some repute, then they started telling her, nobody will marry you.
Mm-hmm.
Because nobody will marry a boxer.
Right, right. Mm?
Yeah.
So then she married. Mm. And then some of them said, you will never have kids because you're a boxer.
Yeah.
And then she was talking about the time she got married.
Mm.
And she went, you know, she went to her husband's new house in the village. And she says almost the entire village ostracized her. They just cut her off socially because she says part of it was that the women in the village could not fathom that there was this one woman who was getting to live her dream, live the life she wanted, while the rest of them were just, you know, struggling at home. And she said, so many times I have felt I have to give this up. Mm. You know, I can't deal with this negativity. I don't want this anymore.
Yeah.
And she says, but for my father-in-law and my husband, I would have given it up.
Mm.
But she says, they would every single day remind me that none of this is about you. It is about their mindset.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
It is your responsibility to get up every morning and go to the boxing ring and bring honor to this country and bring honor to yourself, for yourself.
Yeah.
That is your duty.
Right.
And she says, eventually I bought that story.
Mm-hmm.
She says, I learned to cut out all the negativity. I shed all the guilt I was feeling about leaving my children at home and going out.
Yeah.
And she says, once you do this, she says, you'll never get anywhere if you don't dream.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That giving up on that dream is not an option for me. She says, I've worked too hard, so I'm not going to give up. And now I've trained myself to not listen to the naysayers.
Yeah.
I only listen to the things that I'm focused on. My dreams are what I listen to.
Perfect plan. Yeah.
It's fantastic. Yeah. Just listening to you talk about all these amazing stories. I think they've also had a very profound effect on your life because.
Absolutely.
I think.
Absolutely. Yeah. Just like interacting with these people, I'm sure.
I learn every single interaction, like you said, every single interaction, I come back with a, you know, sack full of.
Knowledge, wisdom.
No, really. Really. It feels funny to say that, you know. A lot of people think that, oh, you lived to be 53 and you've written 5 books and you know everything. Mm. It's not like that. Every single interaction, you learn something. And that's what now I, you know, maybe in my 40s, when I had done a lot, sometimes I think I used to feel that, been there, done it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now I don't feel that.
Right.
Now I think that, abhi to shuru hua hai. You know, the journey is just beginning.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think that's what like pushes you to write. Just the experiences involved.
And that's what also pushes me to write nonfiction because it gives me the opportunity to meet all these wonderful people.
Right.
You know, if I was just writing fiction, I would probably be sitting in my...
Again, isolated with your own imagination.
So, non-fiction is my way of connecting with the world.
I love that.
And think, also being a constant student.
Beautiful thought.
I think similar to how you learn from interaction, for us at the doing this podcast has been a form of interaction where we
You guys must be having fun.
Oh, yeah. We love it. We get a chance to speak to people at length who we would probably never get a chance to speak to, who are like way more accomplished than us. So we are always collecting information or wisdom from guests like you. So it was
great to
have you on the show. And where are your books available?
Absolute pleasure.
Oh, everywhere. All the bookstores and Amazon and
everywhere.
That is one of the blessings of my life.
Great.
Yes. So thank you so much for having me over. It was wonderful to talk to you both.
And it was long due, Sudha. I'm so glad you could make it.
And it was a real delight. I mean, there are a few podcasts which we always remember in hindsight as the fun ones. I think this was a fascinating conversation with a lot of laughter. So it was great having you.
Thank you. So Feisty at 50.
Yes.
Thanks a lot.
And a big thank you to all our listeners. You can follow the Open Library Project on LinkedIn, Instagram and Facebook for latest updates on our events. And stay tuned for the next Paperback podcast on IVM Podcasts. Happy reading. You can follow IVM Podcasts on Facebook, Instagram and Twitter at IVM Podcasts. Listen to Paperback on the IVM Podcast app, website or wherever you listen to podcasts.
Look, up in the internet. It's a meme. No, it's a cat video. No, it's the Geek Fruit Podcast.
That's right. We interrupt this riveting broadcast to tell you about our show, the Geek Fruit Podcast, where Tejas, Dinkar and I, Jishnu, talk about everything in pop culture, including DC, Marvel, Star Wars, Netflix and everything in between.
You know how your friends hate it when you ramble about some nerdy crap and you just want somebody to listen to you? Well, sorry, there's nothing we can do about that, but come listen to us ramble and it'll almost be like the real thing. Kind of.
Listen to new episodes of the Geek Fruit Podcast every Monday and the Geek Fruit Bulletin every Thursday on iTunes, Google Podcasts, the IVM app, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Happy listening, you nerds.
माणसांना गोलगप्प्यासारखी असतात. हाय हॅलो करताना वेगळी आणि बोलताना वेगळी आणि गप्पा मारताना वेगळी. मित्र झाली की वेगळी आणि शत्रू म्हणून वेगळी. थोडक्यात दिसणारी वेगळी आणि असणारी वेगळी. कधी आंबट, कधी गोड, कधी तिखट, तर कधी चमचमीत आणि कधी कधी हॉट अँड स्पायसी सुद्धा. आणि म्हणूनच गप्पा, सॉरी गोल गप्पा विथ तृप्ती खामकर फक्त तुमच्यासाठी दर बुधवारी IVM पॉडकास्टच्या ऍपवर, वेबसाईटवर किंवा युट्यूब चॅनलवर सुद्धा ऐकू शकता. तुम्ही आमचा पॉडकास्ट वेगवेगळ्या पॉडकास्ट प्लॅटफॉर्म्सवरती ऐकू शकता. फक्त सर्च करा गोल गप्पा विथ तृप्ती खामकर आणि आमचा पॉडकास्ट ऐकत राहा.